We will get started. It's a nice crowd this afternoon. Yes, cookies always draws a crowd. All right, welcome to this year's Tabula Poetica reading series. It is great to see all of you here this afternoon. Tabula Poetica runs a series every fall, so we have more visiting poets coming. Mark your calendars ahead of time. October 6th is Alan Shapiro, and December 1st is Aline Lipkin. The bookstore is actually here and has those books by those poets. Alan Shapiro's book, Little Pig, is that the name of it? Little Pig, is...
Light Pig?
Life Pig is just out, so I'm pretty sure none of you have it yet. It's been out like a week. So they have copies there, and you can read up for the next poet. The series ends every fall with the MFA poetry reading. This year, that's on December 15th. It's at 4 o'clock, just like this reading, but it's over in the Fish Interfaith Center. Pull out your phone. Everybody pull out your phone. All right, tweet and Facebook that you're here, and then silence your phone. So don't have your phone buzzing while we're in the reading. Most of the support for this project comes from the English department. The whole university has been very supportive of poetry here, and the English department supports Tabula Poetica and the journal Tab in particular. I want to thank our department chair, Joanna Levin, and our department admin, Kristen Laxo. They do all the behind the scenes funding and logistics, so the food, the chairs, that's Kristen making sure that happens. Leatherby Libraries, where we are now, in the Center of American War Letters, and Fish Interfaith Center, where we were earlier today, and their deans, Charlene Baldwin and Gail Stearns, are great hosts for the whole Tabula Poetica series. I also want to thank Poets and Writers for support they provide through grants that organization has from the James Irvine and Hearst Foundations. I think that's all the welcome. Now we get to the introduction. Here's what you've been waiting for. Cecilia Wallach has been on my poetry radar and on my list of possible Tabula Poetica visitors for several years now. I moved her to the top of the list last year after a graduate student expressed interest in this poet's work and background. So I had always been wanting to invite Cecilia, and then a student actually found her work on her own and said, "We need to bring this poet here." So if there are other poets you know that you want to bring here, especially if they're local, that would be great. Let me know. Cecilia Wallach lives in the Los Angeles area, but considers herself an on-the-road poet. It's, on her website, she uses on-the-road several times, and it made me think about how I was reading her work, and also, I now understand what that means, because when we booked her for Tabula Poetica, I assumed that she would drive down from Los Angeles from where she lives. Instead, she's flown in for this event, and that was unexpected, and I know that makes it a long day for her. We're grateful that she's here to kick off our series this year. Cecilia's most recent book, Earth, and the one I'm teaching for my class is this chapbook, Earth, and it's from a relatively new and absolutely wonderful press called Two Sylvias. If you don't know Two Sylvias, check out their website, not just for Cecilia's book, but for the other books that they're doing. In that book's opening poem, I also hear the on-the-road poet who has been promised no home but the story I've lived toward. No home but the story I've lived toward. This is a poet who looks at the world and her possibilities in it expansively. If you were at the talk this afternoon, I think you heard that as well. In the closing poem from Earth, she writes, "I mean, if I'm going to die, let me live. I mean, if I'm going to die, let me live." Cecilia Wallach grew up in Pittsburgh and Kentucky and has been a Californian since 1979. She has published at least 6 poetry collections by my count and also a novel in vignettes that is, unsurprisingly, about a woman on the road in Europe. She has won numerous awards and grants, including fellowships from the National Endowment for the Arts and from the Center for International Theater Development in Poland. Out of her expansive view of the world and its possibilities, she teaches poetry to children and to senior citizens, to inmates and to the homeless, and of course, to all of us here today. She collaborates with other artists, including musicians, filmmakers, and other visual artists. Most universities toss around the term interdisciplinarity. Here at Chapman, we celebrate interdisciplinary thinking and writing, and today we do that in Cecilia Wallach. Please welcome our poet.
It's terrible to be introduced and you say, who is that person they're talking about? And I have to get up. Thank you for being here. Welcome. I know some of you were in the Interfaith Center this afternoon, yes? So I talked then about something new that, to my own surprise, I'm working on. Poetry always surprises me. It's like, where did that come from? Well, in this case, I know exactly where it came from. I do spend a lot of time in Paris. Paris is one of the places that feels to me like home. And in a particular neighborhood that's kind of centered around the Place de la République. And if you were following the news, what happened in that neighborhood on November 13th? Remember? Yeah, okay. So I wasn't there at the time. I had been there the month before for a month. It's the neighborhood where my friends who are like family live. This is, you know, my relationships with people there go back 25 years, and when you become accepted into a French family, I mean, that's it. You know, it's a life thing. And also, I haven't lived in a home with a television since 1974. So I tell people, I don't watch television, I don't know how. I mean, I stopped watching television before there were remotes, and I literally don't know how to use a remote. You look like you feel so sorry for me, but it's just, you know, it's just one of those things that kind of went out of my life, and I didn't miss it, and don't like it, in fact. So on November 14th, in the afternoon, I was at home working at my desk and got a phone call from a friend in Atlanta who said, oh my God, turn on the news. And so I spent a lot of time, I suppose it's how New Yorkers felt after 9/11, or people who feel that attachment to New York. But now, when you think about it, I mean, it was just, Facebook had a thing where you could check in with people. We were calling, finding out who's safe, who's where, because it was a Friday night in the neighborhood. Everybody's out, you know, people are going to restaurants, people are sitting out in cafes. And so I started, once I started this kind of calling everyone, and then I started obsessively watching reports and news on the internet and people giving testimony in French and in English, the police, the dogs, the police dog that was blown up. And I was, you know, turned inside out by that. I thought, how do we reckon this? How do we absorb it on a spiritual level, on the level of soul? As somebody who believes deeply in the creative capacity of human beings, how do I reckon this? How do I reckon that a young man would walk into a room full of young people and look them in the face and open fire and then destroy his own body? I think, how did we get here? And where do we go from here? I wasn't trying to find an answer. I was just trying to anchor myself. So I turned, as I always do, to poetry. And the books of poetry I pulled off the shelf that night, it was about 3 a.m, as usual for me. I had turned all the gadgets off, I'd lit candles, and I pulled W.S. Merwin. Do people know Merwin's work? No? Yes. And a friend of mine who lives in Paris, in fact, who lives in that neighborhood, Margot Berdyshevsky, both of whom are poets who ask the huge questions about the soul unabashedly in their poetry, and ask huge questions about the soul of the world. And so I read for a while, and I meditated for a while, and I, as I will do, I absorbed those things as best I could, and then I began to write. And it was, for me, that those first stages of composition are always, it's a very private thing, I have to kind of block out the world, not think what anyone might think about what I'm writing. I just have to make a big mess on the page, which is what I did. And because I had to get something into words. And I had to find my way through it in words. You know, it's the words are my way into an experience, in a way. Does that make any sense to you? Okay. All right. So. And this poem has had a strange life already, because normally poems of mine, like there was a poem that was up on the Rattle website the other day, and people say, oh, beautiful poem, when did you write that? It's like, oh, well, 2003, you know. So usually things have a long gestation. But in this case, somebody, an editor, wrote to me, and he was starting a new online journal, and he said, do you have anything new? And I said, I have this thing I'm working on, but I don't know if I'm ready to go public with it. And he asked to see it, and then he immediately wrote back, I think within an hour, and asked if he could publish it. And I said, well, you know what, I'm going to trust that. Maybe it needs to be out there. But I have never read it in public, which is unusual for me. So I'm going to read some of it for you today. And I'm going to read this for about 15 minutes, and then I'll read mostly from Earth for about 15 minutes. So. If you start to feel like, oh God, when is she going to stop? Now you know, okay? the other interesting thing that happened here is I didn't have a title for it even. And the editor, I said, I don't know, I'm just calling it Aftermath Paris, although it ended up becoming bigger than that, and I'm still not finished with it. And he said, I think it should be called Rain, as in R-E-I-G-N, Rain of Embers. I said, okay. Yeah. So, Rain of Embers. Pardon me? Yeah. He's a good one. He's the guy who, I'm blanking on his name, he edited Margie, Robert Nazarene. He's a really terrific editor. It begins with a little inscription from Bertolt Brecht. In the dark time, will there also be singing? Yes. There will be singing about the dark time. 1. Aftermath, Paris. Can you make a song of the love of death? And how does it go? The poet asks. Some had been singing before they died. Some had been bringing the food to their lips. Some had been kissing, some had been drunk, some had been screaming, God is good, as they fired into the crowd. Can you make a prayer from the love of death? From the fingerprint of the finger blown off the assassin's hand? Can I love my enemy as myself? Bless the Almighty, the powerless. Bless the boy who was circumcised at 13. Bless the imam's knife. Bless the girls who are being raped, who are strapping on suicide vests. Bless them remotely as they detonate. Bless whoever made the bomb. How do you fight the love of death? I ask my friend, who says, you can't. It only takes 18 years to grow a suicide bomber from a child, and they have this figured out. But who are they, I ask. On the small screen flickering, I watch a young man unfolding, refolding a shirt, the shirt he wore that night. He says, whose blood? He doesn't know. Can I put it away now? He asks. I don't know what to do with it. Can I make a prayer of this? Some died with the food still in their mouths. Some died with the music playing still. Some died in one another's arms. Some were dragged away to live. Hands trembling, lighting a cigarette. It's monstrous, the young man says, when I saw what a bullet could do. A flower of flame, a blossom of blood, a shower of gold hot sparks. Can you make a song from death? I ask my friend. He says, go to sleep. 2. Macbeth. The murderer says, I am one, my liege, whom the vile blows and buffets of the world have so incensed that I am reckless what I do to spite the world. Some died having dreamt of this, to cleanse the world of infidels, to plant a black flag in the sand where there is no law, no love, but the love of death. Whose God? Whose flag? 3. Ratline. One source says the source is everywhere. One source says the source is our enemy. One source says the source is us, with our blundering, with our greed. Big shining vehicles crossing the desert, shining machines in clouds of sand, black flags visible for miles. Some died having dreamt of this. Someone says it's the Russians again. Someone says it's a pipeline moving oil. No, he says, it's a pipeline moving gas. Someone says it began as a shadow movement of the U.S. government. A little truth. A little honor. Is that such a hard thing to wish? One source says children are being taught to fire weapons, to throw grenades, the face of their teacher obscured in the film, the faces of mothers everywhere. One source says the blunders are not blunders, but part of a plan to divide the world. Blood on the pavements of Paris, Beirut, covered with wreaths and candles now. One girl from Los Angeles dead, dark-haired and young, with a name like a flower. 4. Chateau Marmont, Hollywood. He says it's going to take 100 years to clean up the mess we've made. By us, he means Britain, France, the U.S., his country, and mine, our complicity. Bombs going off over children's heads, a rain of dust and broken concrete, and in the piles of rubble, limbs, torn flesh. He's sitting back in his chair in the elegant suite in the elegant hotel. I've got one leg tucked under my hip, one pump kicked off, something sweet in my mouth. I'm trying to shut up for once in my life and just listen. He knows more than I know, I guess, about what's going on in the Middle East, who these holy warriors are, who's putting the money into their hands for more guns and more bombs, who's selling them weapons, who's buying their oil, who, in the first place, put them in place thinking they'd be their best instruments. It's a very sophisticated operation, he says, and stutters a bit. Sophisticated, sophisticated, sophisticated PR. It's like Hollywood, he says, about the videos I'm afraid to watch, the beautiful propaganda, flashes of fire, flags waving, raised fists. And these kids, he says, these kids, they have nothing else, and they're stupid, really stupid. He almost spits the word in disgust. Across the room, our friend has dozed off, sitting up in her chair in their elegant suite. She's tired, or she's had too much wine. Later, she'll wake and smile at us, stand up and stretch, and go to bed. He'll walk me back through the private garden, past the pool where someone yells, fuck, fuck this, or fuck that, or fuck you, though I can't see who through the leafy dark, just the bright blue eye of the swimmerless pool. And we'll stand for a while in a crowd of the wealthy young on the sidewalk along Sunset Boulevard, the valets parking expensive cars for the guests of the elegant hotel. And I'll wonder, where does their money come from? How did they get so much? Some women hobbling on heels so high they look like tilted dolls. Some with faces so famous, so faultless, they don't look human anymore. 5. Dawn raid in Saint-Denis. Abdelhamid Abaoud. And if you're so in love with death, why are you hiding now? Why have you barricaded yourself with your guns against their guns? Who are you and who are they? Masked as you mask yourself, blacking out your only human face. And who was the girl falling in flames? And what was the flower of her name? Were you there when the shots rang out, and some lay down, and some crawled away, and some were hunted still like rats in the basement rooms of the concert hall? We ran through a maze, one young woman says. We found a nook and tried to make ourselves as small as we could get. In Saint-Denis, still the bullets flare where they flared since dawn, like fireworks. And you are barricaded still, and still love every death but your own. They seemed afraid, one young man said, of the men who took hostages in the end. In the end, they hadn't wanted to die. How to make a song from the love of death? How to make a black mask of the dawn of your own once human face? No children in Saint-Denis will go to school today. There would be no books in the world you'd make but the book you call holy and have drenched in the blood of the only world there is. 6. News. One source says it's a rat line moving weapons from Libya through Turkey to Syria. One source says it's the Turkish president's son and his son-in-law getting rich, transporting the terrorists' oil across the desert to the sea. One source says the oil is put onto tankers, then shipped to Malta, to Israel. One man says from his prison cell, you need to think like a woman, for men only fight for power. That's Abdullah Öcalan, the founder of the Kurdistan Workers' Party. 7, the sixth day, Saint-Denis, Alfortville. The detonations went on for hours. That's how enormous the arsenal was. Almost incalculable, they say. The weapons stockpiled in those rooms, the rounds of ammunition fired. And those dead inside, so dead at last, they could not be identified. A floor collapsing, a ceiling collapsing, one young woman's body exploding in flames. Are you safe, I type, keep safe. To my friend in another Paris suburb where a safe house has been found. Two rooms abandoned, strewn with trash, pizza boxes and chocolate wrappers, rubber tubing and used syringes. Here, the camera swerves and stops. Are the children safe? I type. To my old love, whose daughter is named for one white flower in Arabic, whose son is almost already the age of the young men who attacked, who were not much more than boys. One father bows his head and says he'd prayed that his son was already dead. The son who had kidnapped his younger brother, 13, and taken the boy to Syria. One father opens his arms and says, this country gave us everything. One young man's father comes to the door. Did you know, the reporters ask. Did I know, he says, did I know? If I had known, I'd have killed him myself. How to make a prayer from the love of death? They'd been drug dealers, petty thieves. They'd been in prison. They were young. Then they put on the black masks of warriors and called this holy war, jihad, and call in death for the end of the world. Let this not be the end of the world. But who put the weapons into their hands? On whose hands now the blood of the young turned to flowers, turned to flame? Have we chosen the wrong men to lead us? Have we made the wrong people rich? Have we put power into the hands of those who love power as much as death? How will I know my enemy in the end if the air is full of poison gas? A man kneels in the street where wreaths have been laid and tells his small son, "Yes, the flowers protect us." The child believes. The young woman whose body fell in flames had only begun to wear the veil. She didn't know what it meant, they say. She was smitten with her cousin. She was in love with him. She screamed, "He's not my boyfriend," as she fell. The detonations went on for hours. The dead in the rooms behind the barricade could not be identified. They had been drug dealers, thieves, locked up, or they had been welcomed with open arms, or they had been boys once, given to suck, as all boys are in these times, on the pornography of violence, in which a woman becomes a bomb, in which the flower of her sex becomes a passageway to death. Can they be forgiven? Can we? Can the God in the girl still rise up? Sing. 8. Veering. And let he who is without sin cast the first stone, and let she who is without blame fall blamelessly in flames, and let our rocket launchers not fall into the hands of our enemies. But who are our enemies now? A rat line, some say, transporting weapons from Libya to Syria, a shadow government, some say, transporting the terrorist oil across Turkey to the sea. 2 million children fleeing into the arms of what country now? A medieval moment, says my friend, the child of the children of slaves. Some people who have everything don't want anyone else to have anything. A man in prison in Kirkuk from a family of 17 worked building car bombs to feed his family. What other work could he get, he asks. What other choice did he have? When the Americans came in, they got rid of Saddam and gave us this. Under Saddam, we were starving, but at least we were alive. And the God of the men who paid for the bombs is not his God, he says. Their God is not my God. And the boys in Europe who flocked to Syria wanted adventure, wanted blood, wanted the Hollywood promised them, wanted a God who loved them best. Death to the infidels. Death to Noemi Gonzalez, who sat in a Paris cafe with her friends. Death to Abdalhamid Abaoud, who planned the attacks in which how many died. Death to the man in prison in Kirkuk, sentenced to death. More death. How many deaths to feed whose God to empty the world of infidels? A boy with a stone in his hand rears back. The sky fills with falling stars. Have we veered off course? Have we tilted the world toward rat line, poison gas? Have we made of our weapons a God who will not answer when we call? Nine, Lauren, Los Angeles. Or have we loved wrongly all along? A young woman comes to my door in Los Angeles, years since I saw her last, and with something pleading in her eyes, something harmed, "I would not have you harmed." I invite her to sit. I pour wine. She asks for a cigarette, a light. She wasn't much more than a girl when we met. She was my student, a favorite then. Now she's tasting the smoke, which is bitter. Now she's drinking the wine, which is sweet. Now she's asking if I'm afraid. We talk. We agree on the shadows between us. Everywhere blame, lines blurring, crossed. The shadow governments, shadow wars, the shadow weapons and shadow arms. And the man who'd lived for 2 years in her house, who'd slept in her bed and shared her food, called her from prison last week for help, having beaten another woman badly enough to have finally broken the law. A felony, she says. I was just lucky it wasn't me. I tell her that I was just lucky too, that we're all lucky to be alive, because women die for love. Some women die in the name of love. Some women die unnamed, unloved. The young woman in Saint-Denis, whose name is on no one's tongue, calling out from the midst of the explosions, help me, please, calling out, he's not my boyfriend, the last words to ever leave her mouth, then the detonation, the bomb, her body turning to flame in the air, her head and her spine, two separate pieces, cinder and bone on the pavement below. Whoever loved that girl, I wonder, who loved to party, to drink and smoke, her friends say, calling her clueless now, and these were her friends, who loved that girl, whose mother and father had given her up as a child into foster care, who had lived nowhere and everywhere, who had only begun to wear the veil, who didn't understand what it meant, who stood flaming in the sky a moment, then burning, fell through the air. Stupid, I think. Stupid kids who thought they loved death until death came for them. And my young friend, ash in her palm, trembling a little, agrees. And Paul, on the road to Damascus, hearing the voice of Christ in the wind, asking, why do you persecute me? Turned in terror to love, called love the fulfillment of the law. Love is the fulfillment of the law. But where is the law when you need the law? A young man had tried to flee the concert hall in the midst of the chaos and bullets and blood. He'd climbed out a window and clung to a bare wall 3 stories above the street. Just below him, a woman also clinging, but slipping. I'm slipping, she sobbed. I'm pregnant. I can't hold on. So the young man pulled himself back inside, what could he do, and ran down the stairs and pulled her to safety. Was she safe? And so he was caught himself, held hostage by the terrorists, barricaded below, because in the end they'd been terrified. In the end, they hadn't wanted to die, because the body wants to live. They sat with their backs against a wall, young men like him, but with guns in their arms, and one threw a wad of cash at his feet, and, do you love money? He asked. And when the young man told him no, the young man with the gun said, burn it then. Later, his body so pulverized, he could not be identified, except by the prints of one fingertip, spit. And how did the other young man survive? The young cops in the street stood trembling among the body parts, broken glass, the pavement blood-stained when dawn finally came, the dog they'd loved blown apart in the barrage. Where is the law when you need the law? Where is love as she falls in flames? My young friend smoking a cigarette, the dark machines screaming through the sky over Damascus as we speak. This is the last section, 10. Elizabeth, City of Angels. This has an epigraph from W.S. Merwin. They had a power for death we wanted. Are these then the holy wars? Is this jihad martyrdom? For a heaven so filled with virgins, the seams of heaven explode? Now a mass grave has been found, filled with the corpses of women too old to have been the warriors' wives or their slaves. But who put the weapons into their hands? Who took their money, drank their oil? We're riding downtown in a car for hire, my friend beside me, whose sight is failing, her hand resting lightly in my hand, the sleek car gliding through the gleam of the City of Angels, Los Angeles. Our dark-skinned driver glancing back in the rearview mirror, smiling at us. Guess where it is, he asks, my favorite country in Africa. Because my friend likes to talk to strangers. She likes to ask them where they've been, and she's asked, and he wants us to ask him where his favorite country is. He wants to tell us, so tell us, she says. Rwanda, he answers, his smile lighting up in the rearview mirror. Because after the genocide there, so few men were left alive. It's a country of women and children now. A new country of the young, he says. And the women who've taken the law and the government into their hands hold everyone accountable. Because all the warriors are dead. Because they killed one another so well. Allahu Akbar, God is great, or maybe just good, and good is enough. My friend who is losing her sight, for whom light is failing, thanking him. That's that. Sorry. I feel like I've maybe just subjected you to something. Just try to switch gears here. I'm going to read the opening poem from Late, which is an obad and also a prose poem. An obad, you probably know, is traditionally a poem or song written from a doorway or window to a sleeping woman in a bed. It was traditionally the song that one lover slipping away just before dawn composed to the other, the one who was left, who was usually the woman, but sometimes we can turn that around. So, obad. Now the trees stand outside of desire. Stricken with silver, stripped leafless, alarmed. Still they long to be seen, throw themselves skyward with open arms, just as the earrings, obsidian, gleam where they lie, having longed to be taken off, not to be rid of themselves, but to hint at undressing, dalliance. Oh, brilliance of being a beautiful thing in a world full of beautiful things, in which even suffering shimmers and means, in which even the lover's absence pools in the shadows at my feet. I can step back from the window or not. I can choose to be just as lovely without ever being watched, as the bare trees make cradles for birds, as he once cupped the black tear-shaped jewels in his palm. Oh, world, hold us up to this light. There is so much to lose that we haven't lost. This next poem is probably my most anthologized poem. It's a pantoum. It was the first pantoum I ever wrote, and it's a recycled pantoum because there were lines from another poem that was a failed poem, lines from an attempt at a poem, and I thought, well, I'm not using these, so maybe I'll try something else with them. You know how pantoum is constructed? Does everybody know that? No? Okay. Pantoums, it was originally Malaysian fishing songs were, that's where the form comes from, and it must have been a call and response kind of thing, because a pantoum is constructed in quatrains, four lines, and line two and line four of each quatrain roll over and become lines one and three of the next quatrain. So the good news is every time you get to the next quatrain, it's already half written. The bad news is you have to come up with two lines that fit in between and keep the pantoum going and can roll over and become one and three of the next quatrain. And you can keep going forever if you want. But eventually, you have to take lines one and three from the first quatrain and weave them in as two and four of the last quatrain. So everything gets repeated like that. I spent the best years of my childhood in rural Kentucky, where you could ride horses anytime you could catch one in a field, throw a rope around it. But this is all of this is true. I couldn't make any of this up. I hope the poem tells the whole story, but people were constructing a house on the hillside near us, and they made a bonfire to burn some scrap lumber, and they left and left it burning, and it looked like it was getting out of hand. And so this was the perfect excuse for my sister and I and a couple of local guys to ride around on horseback all night through the woods and miss school the next day. Bareback Pantoum. One night, bareback and young, we rode through the woods, and the woods were on fire. Two borrowed horses, two local boys whose waists we clung to, my sister and I, and the woods were on fire. The pounding of hooves, the smell of smoke, and the sharp sweat of boys whose waists we clung to, my sister and I, as we rode toward flame with the sky in our mouths. The pounding of hooves, the smell of smoke, and the sharp sweat of boys, and the heart saying, mine, as we rode toward flame with the sky in our mouths, the trees turning gold, then crimson, white, and the heart saying, mine, of the wild, bright world, the trees turning gold, then crimson, white, as they burned in the darkness, and we were girls of the wild, bright world, of the woods near our house. We could turn, see the lights as they burned in the darkness, and we were girls, so we rode just to ride through the woods near our house. We could turn, see the lights, and the horses would carry us home. So we rode just to ride, my sister and I, just to be close to that danger, desire. And the horses would carry us home. Two borrowed horses, two local boys, my sister and I, just to be close to that danger, desire. One night, bareback and young, we rode through the woods. You don't clap after every poem, because then I'll be self-conscious. Ooh, they didn't clap for that one. They must not like it.
That's my copy.
I was going to say, wow, my book grew.
Stuff in there.
No, it's like, wow, that's a big, thicker book than I read. I'll read a couple of poems from Earth. This is the little chapbook that two Sylvias did. They're a great press, and they have this chapbook competition every year, so just saying. What was promised me? Nothing. A ring and some salt. Rice in the white shoes, music, a doll. The book my mother read to me over and over when I was a child. Tigers turning to butter, to milk. An amulet from a boy who carried a knife in his pocket, too. Night. I was not promised dawn. Stars hooked to sky by my father's hands. Love like a tree I could climb to the top of and then jump down from or swing from or fly. Mercies so small I could hide each one inside a flower. Sharp white teeth. A clock made of pearls, each pearl an hour and the hours numberless. The pink dress that disappeared, where did it go? And the tiny ballerina spinning and spinning inside a dome. A door that would open and close. No house, no home, but the story I've lived toward. Luck running out like a shimmer of wind. Two buckets full of cold water, wood for a fire, and flame. This is the poem I mentioned earlier today that I started in 1994 and finished in 2014. So I know that seems like that's your whole life, right? More. But, you know, while you were becoming a person, I was working on, I didn't work on it continuously for, while you were having a life, I didn't work on it continuously for 20 years. In fact, it was one of the things I just, it was a kind of half done thing that got put in a file somewhere, and then I stumbled across it. And, you know, 20 years later, I said, wow, there's a lot of really bad writing in this poem. But the ending was really, there was something there that I didn't even know what it was. There was, the poem made a kind of a leap at the end, and I said, it was also, I had been writing about one of my great aunts, my father's aunts, who were these kind of old brujas who scared me when I was a kid. And they were very mysterious because they wouldn't say where they had come from. Their English was strange. They were sort of like, you know, fortune tellers. And I realized that in 1994, I didn't know, it took me 20 years to learn not only where they'd come from, but the history of that place, which had been erased, and what this aunt of mine, who was great aunt of mine, we called them Teta. And nobody's even sure, really, this language, this word comes from a language that's not really a language and isn't spoken anymore. So it took me 20 years to learn what I had to learn to be able to finish the poem. And then it was just another 75 or 80 drafts. So you tell me if it was worth it. I don't know. Teta, for my great aunt. And my father's family, they when they came from the old country, you know, the old country, maybe they don't use that expression anymore, they moved to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where they worked in, a lot of men worked in mills and coal mines, and my family ended up, as a lot of poor people do, involved in a lot of criminal, or stuff that was considered criminal. Oh yes, my grandmother went to jail and took all her kids with her. Teta, for my great aunt. Teta, it's winter in Pittsburgh again. Dark brick city of smokestacks and soot. And we're walking up Broadway Avenue, past billboards and vacant lots, through the slush of snow and cinders, as the streetcars slur past, ghosts in our flowered babushkas and shabby coats, shopping bags weighing down our arms. We've bought cans of beets, heads of cabbage, meat ground fresh that will squeeze into fists. And we don't flinch when the crew cut kids hiss DPs at our backs. We're not ashamed anymore, at last, to have come from nowhere, nothing, dirt. The village you fled as a young girl, gone. The houses burned and the fields you worked into rows of green grown wild again. Once you spooned honey into my mouth because my arms and legs were like sticks, because I itched and wept and wanted more than sweetness to know who I was. But you sighed, no one wants to remember that stuff. How you came to this new country stinking of ship. How you sold bootleg hooch for cash, your own smooth flesh for a rich man's song. The rich growing fat on the fat of the land, while you buried one child in a pauper's grave, raised two others on blood money, prayer, all your sins in a basket too heavy to lift, and your body already a heap of grief, the day you slipped in the alley and fell in that garden you'd made of ground bone, ash, under a slit of tin-washed sky. And then you never stood up again. I watched as you shrank in your narrow bed, blind, but you gripped my hand and sang the old song of the little bird in a tongue I still don't understand. Dark syllables fluttering just out of reach, until you were shadow, whisper, less. Your whole life a ragged story, stitched into breath, unstitched again. Teta, we've never been much in this world, although we were many, too many once. The children's children who circled your table, blowing out candles, eyes tilted like yours. Our faces the same face all over again. The face of the stranger wherever we turned. My cousin, the Cossack, the Gypsy, the Jew. My cousin, the dark Slav. My cousin, the slave. And we'll never belong to this place where you came with your one suitcase tied with rope, your shape like a shadow risen from earth, some mute root pulled from a meadow where wildflowers blazed in the summer and winter lay down. This is America, Teta. You're dead. And our dying means nothing here. Give me your bags. In the name of whatever country this is. It's warm here now, and the fields have no coats. The fields have no women singing and bending toward them, no men with their backs in the sun. Still, it's warm here, and something might grow. Something might sow itself from the earth of the fields of whatever country this is. Then the ghosts will have something to harvest. The ghosts will have something with which to make bread. Their coats in the forest hanging like mist, their shoes in the river washing away. Then what a feast it might be at last, in the name of the long gone, the ashen dead. Let come the rain and the animals too. Let them be eaten again in the name of the god of whatever country this is, where the fields almost naked lie down to flower, where peace, like the mouth of a flower, opens to swallow, be swallowed, the fields. Read two more poems. This was written in the year 2006. I was returning to Poland, to the Carpathians, where I would stay with friends in a house we called the glorified shed. And the forests all around this area, which is the area that my grandmother came from, the forests all around during World War II were so full of different partisan groups, you know, pro-Soviet groups and Jewish groups and Gypsy groups and Polish partisans, and the blood, you know, so soaked the earth that once we were walking through the forest and you could feel something hard, and it was like where 2x4s had been set down so the tanks could get through. And another time, a neighbor, an old man who had been in the Polish, the AK, the Polish army, showed up at the door at dusk in his uniform, afraid and asking, "Have the Germans already gone?" 2006. In the year of the poppy, year of the cornflower, year of the meadow of yarrow and buttercup, year of the thistle and ox-eyed daisy, in the spring of the year of our Lord, of the train, the engine, the ticket, the map, of the landscape of leaf shadow, willow, white birch, blurring past in the smoke of the burning fields, in the blue mist of evening, the ringing of bells, ringing out for the living, the dead, of the last great war, which is one long war, of the ancient soldier come in his uniform to stand hopefully at the door of the house of no mirrors, swept of ash, in which I was a guest of the dark bread and rain, to ask, "Have the Germans already left?" 60 years after, the forests were flushed of the last of our enemies, last of the partisans of the Holy Republic of Mud, of the blood mixed with earth, of the bones of itself, of which no one knows but the trees anymore, of which no one speaks but the child made of grass. And this is what I want my afterlife to be. Think about what you want to be, besides an angel, if you want to be an angel. I don't particularly. Thank you. Thanks. Afterlife. I want to be fierce and joyful and a meadow when I'm dead. Spindly flowers and waist-high grass and the shadows of clouds across that brightness, shifting like so many ships in the sky. I want to be all in one place at last, but vast, a sea by the side of the road. I mean green, and I mean poppies and daisies, everything blooming at once. And I want to be again that girl who pushed into the wind, who stood up to the sun, big-mouthed and brave. I mean, if I'm going to die, let me live. Let me wade out into the darkest part of the night and name myself. Wild-haired bitch of the mongrel stars, moon on her shoulders, dirt rich, proud. Thank you.
Some questions about the poem that Cecilia read, or about poetry more generally, or about the poetry writing process. Any questions out there?
What kind of car I drive?
I didn't want to get out of here.
What was that?
How did you come to write the long poem?
I just felt like I had no choice. I just had to do, I hadn't been writing poetry, I'd been working on prose. So it was a really wonderful moment for me in a horrible way. But I think I said at the beginning, I got the news from a friend. I was calling friends in Paris. I became obsessed with the news and with reading about this as if it's up to me to figure it out, you know, to find out who's behind it all. And then I prayed and wrote and read Merwin and read Margaret Bedeshevsky and gave myself permission to just, it's like, I'm not trying to be articulate. I'm not trying to, all I'm trying to do is work through this in language. So I didn't show it to anybody for a really long time. Somebody had a funny question here or comment, no? What did she say?
I think there was a question in the middle.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Similar to that one, but like the Paris one seemed to have like a ton of details. What was doing research for that like?
It was just me sitting in front of my computer and like reading articles, and because I could get some French news sources, and I guess we can all get them, I'm not all that savvy, but I just kept reading and reading and reading about it. And then I have some interesting, the man who does my taxes subscribes to a newsletter called Miltech. And this is a newsletter for people who invest in military technology. So the information is written, and it's written by a man who was a procurement specialist for the Navy and is also a geologist, so he knows about oil and stuff. So it's not a like weird conspiracy theory thing on Facebook. I mean, this is something investors pay to get this. And this is, and I just, he knows that he knew that I was kind of just on this information binge. And so he started forwarding these newsletters to me, and then Seymour Hersh. And you can just go down that rabbit hole of, you know, one link takes you to another. But just kept reading and being more horrified and talking to people. And the guy who keeps folding the shirt, you know, I kept watching him, you know, talking. It was like it was not long after the attack, and he was telling the story, and he was trembling and smoking and showing the shirt. So it was like everything just came in. It's like, okay, everything that came in, I'm just going to put it in there and, you know, see what happens.
Is that your usual mode of writing, or was that a very different way of writing?
It felt very different to me because I had not been writing like poetry. I had not been writing poetry. And if I wrote any poetry, it was kind of by accident writing prose poems. But I do tend to sit up late at night and allow myself to just kind of write whatever and to try to not judge it, to try to not, you know, outrun the inner critic, that censor that says, because I was writing a lot, it's like, oh, that's stupid. How can you write that over and over and over and over again? But I did it anyway. And that way it's similar. In terms of the feeding myself with all this information, no, that wasn't. I mean, I did it somewhat in Cigan, but there wasn't so much information to find. When I was writing Cigan in 1999, there was very little published material about Roma, about gypsies, about their history, and there was, the internet wasn't, I mean, it's really different. I think we had email, but I think that's about it. So that was different, but I didn't like take notes and write. I would just kind of read and absorb, and then when I sat down to write, what stayed with me, like the mass grave, like the last thing, it's like they found a mass grave filled with female skeletons. And these were the girls they had captured and kidnapped. Nobody knows how many. Nobody will ever know who those girls were. The families will be too ashamed. And it was a mass grave. You know, I don't know, hundreds, thousands of skeletons. And then we get in an Uber with a driver who's telling, and my friend is going blind, so she holds my hand. And she loves to talk to people, and the driver wants us to, he's traveled a lot in Africa, and wants to tell us about Rwanda, where all the men have killed one another. There's so few men. I love men. I'm not bashing men. I love men. And I feel like one of the things that was hard for me about writing that was, these are boys. They're boys. And a lot of them are beautiful boys, and they're blowing themselves up, and they're, it's like, what's behind that? So anyway, but so the driver, the Uber driver is, you know, telling us about Rwanda. And my friend is, you know, thanking him for telling us, you know. So I don't know what any of it means, but it just is all there. I just wanted to put the things I was seeing like side by side. I was trying to see them up against one another myself.
Makes sense.
Yeah, I am. In some way, yes. But I don't think there's really sense to be made other than to kind of step back, and because I feel like in some way we're all complicit. I mean, everybody, and I don't just mean Americans, I mean, we're all complicit in some way. This is the world we've made. This is the world we've made. And I'm not hopeless at all. I'm not hopeless at all. But I couldn't just turn away from that. I could write like that until 3 or 4 in the morning, and then I could sleep. Then I could sleep. Mm-hmm. Yes, Logan.
I think you used the phrase pornography of violence.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so you're trying to respond to how you feel in that passage. Mm-hmm. But you're sensitive in a number of different ways, and you're not replicating that phenomenon. But the art of poetry, as you practice it, you're referring to it, but you're not citing it, not precisely. There's a critique, right?
Right. No. I think you're right. I mean, I feel very strongly about that. And I think, well, it's okay because it turns a profit. What if we did this? I have these great ideas. If I were president, if I were queen, what if we just tried for a year to not make killing a game? What if we just tried that? What if we just said, okay, just for a year, no more games where killing is a fun thing that makes you great. Let's see what happens with that. What do you think?
Good luck persuading people.
Well, because it makes money, you know? And we draw the line at certain things and at other things. It's like, well, we draw the line at child porn, sort of, you know? Slavery made a lot of people money.
Still does.
So I just, you know, I guess it's all about consciousness. And I don't think I can continue to work the way, I mean, nothing brings you, you know, if you've practiced an art form, nothing brings you greater satisfaction than doing it. I tell people, oh, it's nice to have a book published. Nothing feels as good as like making a poem, as finishing something, as getting something down in language. And in order to be able to continue to do that, I have to keep this pact with myself to keep the channel open. As Martha Graham said to Agnes DeMille, you know, you have to keep the channel open. If I say, oh, I don't want to think about that stuff. I want to close down that part of my consciousness. Well, you do that at your own, what's the word, not risk?
What's the word?
Peril. Thanks. It's been a long day. So in order to keep, you know, that part of myself awake and alive, I just felt like I can't turn away from this. And I think it's different, you know, for all of us. There are different things that all of us can bear witness to. And my thing about that is I always have really been, I come from a family that's really passionate about politics, about everything, but especially about politics. And I despaired of ever being able to get that into my poems because I thought, well, most political poetry that I would read, or, you know, it felt like it was rhetoric, it had an agenda, there wasn't that beauty of language, it wasn't incandescent, it didn't go beyond itself, it didn't transcend. And that's why, you know, I tried to make a case for, this for me was very personal. And so the lens through which I allowed it in was very personal, you know. It's like all my friends are in the poem, some of them named, some of them not. Not all of my friends, I have more friends than a few. But, I just think that you can't, you know, I don't want to preach to anyone, I don't want to preach to myself. I don't have an answer. I just say, let's look. There was a discussion, I'm editing the literary journal where I'm teaching, and there was a discussion by the editorial committee of a poem that came in that was an ekphrastic poem based on a painting of the burning at the stake of a bunch of Christians. And the poem, I have never seen the painting, but the poem made the painting so vivid. And one of the student editors said, well, you know, but what does the poem, what's the point, and what does it? I said, I think anything that puts in front of us in a way we can't avoid our capacity for brutality toward one another, I think we need that. We need to be reminded that we have that capacity because I do think we also have a choice. Other questions? Yes.
About slavery,
one question here, and then I'll hold the question about slavery.
So I had a friend who, a very close friend, was at the Bethesda College, and she brought out,
an American friend or French friend?
She's French. Uh-huh. And she actually called me right as she was in the hospital.
Did you know what was going on already?
No. Experience for several days, like just as that was all happening, it was really strange.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt like it was happening to me, even though it was not at all, it was her, but it was just this really strange experience. So when you said you were going to read a poem about that, I was like, oh shit.
Sorry.
I think what was interesting was that you know, there were moments in your poem when, you know, I felt that, like, physical, like, sadness and, you know, from the personal experiences of people there. But I thought that what was interesting to me in kind of processing my own experience of that and was taking it in, like, outside of just that moment of the sort of actual experience of the attack, you know what I mean, and making it bigger and then bringing it back in personal and, you know, to the individuals who were there. And I don't know if that was something that you thought about while you were doing it or if it just kind of worked that kind of back and forth.
If I always am suspicious of my own intentions in poetry because I always hope to write a poem that knows way more than I do. And if I try to impose an agenda on something, I can get in trouble. Then I think you write the kind of political poetry that's polemic. It's like, it's my agenda. It's and rhetoric. And the other thing is I tell people, you know, I try for as long as possible to delay knowing what I'm doing. Because I feel like as soon as I think I know what I'm doing and I say, like, I'm amazed by poets. So, oh, yeah, I'm working on a series of this and that. And I'm like, really? Because I feel like as soon as I think I know what I'm doing, the unconscious will say, oh, so you think you're in charge here, huh? Go ahead. You know? So I didn't think about it. When I start to shape, I think about that to a certain extent, you know? Yeah. But I'm glad your friend survived. But what trauma she must have. Yeah. Trauma. I spent many happy hours in the Bataclan. Yeah. But it's very close. It's always been there. And the fact that it's so close that we have to pay attention to it is maybe not a bad thing. Hard, but maybe not bad. Richard, you had a question or comment?
I have questions because I had something I was going to say something about. about the slavery thing. There's a book just out called The Half That Was Never Told, Slavery and American Capitalism.
Oh, yeah. I read a review.
In slavery, it made a lot of money. Well, it also was responsible for a tremendous amount of economic growth and everything in terms of capitalism after it was ended. So that's all.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean
to. No, that's fine. Question? Yeah.
Just off of purely conceptual and off of like common content. I noticed in your book, in all of your writings, that you have certain themes that you're drawn back to. It seems like dreaming is a common theme, and there are a couple other things that are kind of reoccurring in your writing. And I wonder, just while you write, do you make any attempts to? Are you aware of certain things that you are drawn to as metaphors or, you know, just kind of common metaphorical themes? And if so, do you make any attempts to avoid them in your writing, or are you like...
When I feel like I've started to overuse something, I do. Like my mentor many years ago insisted I take a 1-year vacation from the word heart. And what happens was, you know, as you do, you can start, not only does it start to feel redundant, but you start to use it as a kind of personal shorthand.
Yeah.
So instead of exploring what I really was trying to say or what was really there, heart, there it is, done. And so in this book, though, it's interesting because we do have, I think, you know, I believe that what Rob Brezhne said, treat your obsessions as if they are holy, as if they're direct instructions from God. So we do get, I have been for a long time obsessed with the family stories and with that kind of erased history. And that's made me, that's grown into an obsession with larger erasures. And so I don't, I mean, you... Again, at your own peril, you refuse those things which call to you again and again. But I do, when I feel like I've started to over-rely on certain metaphors or certain language, I try to not do that. Like, I'm trying to not use and so much. Because I realize I was and, it adds a little beat, and, it makes it clear this is connected, because people might not get it. So. I do that. But then when I was putting together Earth and I was looking at these poems, I was like, oh, so here, this comes back again, the branch comes back, and this comes back. And I tried to work with that as I was sequencing the poems so that it wouldn't seem repetitive, but it would seem like there were some threads that were going through.
Cool, you did a really good job on that.
Thanks, because I worked hard. I had spread all over the bed 15, 20 times. Okay.
I think we'll wrap up with a final question from me, and that is, knowing that this is an audience of young, emerging poets, what would one piece of advice or one little nugget of wisdom be, knowing that they're sort of at the beginning and you've got numerous books published, and maybe something you would have liked to have heard?
I think I did hear it. I think I was really lucky. You know, do what you love, really. Joseph Campbell wasn't lying. Follow your bliss, do what you love. Read work that nourishes your inner life and your poetry. Read poetry that you really disagree with so that you can respond to it. Be yourself, everyone else is taken, you know? The only way to be really original is to be completely yourself. Read. I had a political science professor when I was an undergraduate, and he didn't get tenure. He was a great teacher that all the students loved, so he didn't get tenure. But he was like a crazy hippie guy, folk singer, and many years later, he reappeared in my life. He had gone on to become a fabulously wealthy international tax attorney. And we were marveling at how our lives turned out. You know, he and his wife were living in Paris for a while. Now they're in the north of England. I visit them. They let me use their place in Tuscany. It's like, and I said, oh, you know, I do have a great life. I said, you know, just like nobody ever told me I couldn't do what I wanted to do. And he looked at me and he said, nobody would have dared. But I was lucky that, you know, it was, you know. But do what you love. We weigh ourselves down with a lot of things we think we need, and we actually don't. So, you know, I don't want to get on a political diatribe here, but consumer culture convinces us, you know, that we need a lot of things that we really don't need. And they prevent us from having a lot of the things we really want. I drive a 17-year-old pickup truck. I love my truck. And I love that I'm going to Romania in a few weeks and that I can, you know, I can travel because I don't have a car payment and I haven't for 17 years. So, you know, that's a help. Okay.
There was a lot of bits of wisdom.
Bon courage, yeah.
I want to just reiterate that there's food in the back, there are books for sale at the bookstore, and we do have a few copies up front of Cecilia's chapbooks. Earth is here, and
this
we have
one is good
copy
too. That's
of
a good one.
Late. So if you want a chapbook of Cecilia's, come up front. If you already have one and want a book signed, she'll stick around for a few minutes. But definitely eat all the food. I think
if you bring me a cookie.
Yeah, bring cookies to the front. Definitely eat all the food. And thank you, Cecilia.
Thank you. Thanks.
Cecilia,
thank you.